This maybe just became the most advanced color grading tutorial on YouTube. We're gonna do a psychedelic deep dive into color spaces and warp them around. We are going to be creating a film emulation, a parametric power grade film emulation, and I'm gonna show you a method with which you can turn any lookup table into a parametric power grade. And this is my warning, this is gonna be very advanced, but don't worry, you don't actually need to learn anything because you are going to be getting the film emulation power grade for free in the end of the video. So let's go. So here is a film emulation lookup table, which I like. This is emulating Vision3 250D stock and 2383 print, and this is the hype. This is what most film emulation lookup tables or film emulation plugins try to emulate, so this is what we want. And I like it, but there are a few things. First of all, it is a lookup table, so the only thing that I can adjust is the strength, and it only works in one color space. Another thing is that this clamps highlights. You can see how there's details missing in the sky. This is a very common issue with film emulations. And the shadow roll-off is off. The shadows lose details. Now let me show you. If we bring up the exposure here, you can see how we are losing a lot of dynamic range, both in the highlights and in the shadows. So this cannot really be used for HDR workflows, for example. And this is just a personal opinion, but I think the skin tones are a bit too yellow, and that's just my opinion. So in this video, my challenge is to turn this lookup table into a parametric power grade. And here's a bit of a spoiler. This is how the lookup table looks, and this is how the power grade looks. The roll-off is better in the sky and in the shadows, the skin tones are better, and it's all parametric. So it means that all this is done with the native tools in DaVinci Resolve, so you can go and tweak anything you want in this film emulation. And this works with all cameras. And I'll be giving it out for free in the end of the video. Next, let's start building this, but before we go, I need to explain you a bit theory behind what we're gonna be doing. So here we go. Here's a primer for you to understand color spaces, so you can navigate inside this psychedelic world of color. So the basic thing is that there's only three things you can do to a color, depending on the color model that we use. For example, this here is middle gray and its values in RGB color model in 8-bit encoding. And there's only three things you can do to this color. You can either change the red, you can change the green, or you can change the blue. All colors are within these three dimensions. And here is the same color in HSB. This is another color model, hue, saturation, and brightness. And all colors are again inside these three dimensions. And even when there is four values, for example, in the CMYK model, the fourth value, the K, is actually just a combination of the three other values. For example, these two colors are the same color, but the values are different because the K counterbalances the CMY. And even in this case, there's actually only three dimensions. And these values are dimensional. So it means that these three values create a coordinate system with which we can navigate in color space. And so, what is a color space? Well, color space is just an imaginary box. This, for example, is the Rec.709 color space inside the RGB model. And inside this, we have the middle gray. And here are its values. And by modifying the RGB values of this middle gray, we are moving the color around inside the color space. And there's only three things you can do to an individual color. But things get very interesting when we have millions of colors. And now, instead of just three things, there's practically infinite things we can do to our colors, because all colors can move separately. And here we can see, as we apply the film emulation lookup table, how all the colors are moving. The color space is warping. And that is actually what a lookup table is, if you have ever looked inside one. It is a color space warping matrix. And that's not all, because all color modifications, all the native tools, are actually just warping the color space. The native tools, DCTLs, plugins, It's all just warping the color space. Of course, there's other things, but modifications to the color are always just color space warping. Because it's impossible to create a perfect match as the native tools are limiting us, we need to settle for a close estimate. And for that, we need to understand how the color space is actually warping. And for that, we're gonna use some very special diagrams to mark the color space. And when the lookup table warps the color space, we can track how it was warped. And then we will mimic the warping as close as possible with the native tools. Next, I'm gonna show you a speed run of the parametric power grade creation, and I'll explain the diagrams that I'm using along the way. And again, you don't need to remember or learn this or even understand what we're doing. I'll do my best to make sure that you can understand. But if you get bored, just keep to this time frame or time mark. What is this? Time, whatever this time. And then you can see how to use this power grade and how to download it for free. Let's start the speed run. First, I set our diagrams the color space where we want to create our lookup table in this case SSCT and AP1. In the group post clip tab, I'll replicate the LUT with this node tree. Whatever we do to these nodes will affect all the clips inside the group, allowing us to modify multiple diagrams at once. First, I'll set our output device transform to Rec79A as our delivery color space, and now we see all the diagrams in Rec79A. And now we're ready to start. So the first thing I'll do, this node is where I place the LUT I want to recreate. And as you can see, the LUT affects the top part of the image, leaving the lower part for us to create our own replication of this LUT. I'll turn everything to black and white so I can recreate contrast first, as that's the biggest brush and we start with the big brush first. This is our first diagram, a simple flat black and white gradient that shows us the contrast and exposure behavior of our LUT. When we look at this diagram in 3D, inside this three-dimensional vectorscope, we can see that this is a straight line running from black to white inside our color space. Here in the waveform, you can see now two lines. The smooth one is our unaltered contrast, and the crooked one is the film emulation LUT. I'll pop the waveform out, and then I'll pop the curves tool out as well. We don't need to see the viewport for now. Then I'll just recreate the curve to mimic the contrast curve of the LUT, but I don't clip the shadows or the highlights as the LUT does, as you can see from these flat lines in the shadows and in the highlights. Because I want our power grade to be better than the LUT, so I'm not mimicking its flaws. And this allows us to save the dynamic range in the highlights and in the shadows. And when I close the pop-up window, you can see the gradient to be identical in the middle, but starts to deviate in the top and the bottom. And this will fix the highlight clamping and the shadow roll-off from our power grade. Next, I'll turn the black and white node off and start working on the tone curve, offsetting the RGB curves, just like the film emulation does, in order to copy the tone curve. And then I'm happy with the tone curve, and because our grade doesn't clamp the highlights, it looks different in the highlights and in the shadows. But that's actually a good thing, because now we don't have the issues as the lookup table had. And with this mask mode, I can reveal the tone curve of only the lookup table and then compare our grade to it. Our tone curve is much smoother than, and that's an improvement. Next, it's the hue versus saturation diagram. This diagram shows us all hues from the most saturated ones to middle gray. In the 3D vectorscope, we can see how this covers all the middle values of all hues in the color space. I will now start work with the color with the different curve tools. The first tool is the saturation versus luminance curve, and with this I'll set our overall luminance of the highly saturated colors to match the lookup table. Then I'll fine-tune it with the hue diagram. The hue diagram is just a subset of the hue versus saturation diagram. The diagram can be seen in 3D vectorscope as this line that circulates around the most saturated edge of the color space. And when we desaturate it to half, it will now represent the most common colors of our color space, all half saturated hues at half exposure. Looking at the waveform, I'll try to get us as close to the target as we can for now. Then I'll start fine-tuning all the individual hues with the hue versus luminance curve by looking at the waveform and aiming for a smoother roll-off between hues than our LUT. Another improvement. Then let's switch to the 2D vectorscope to see the saturation and hue values. And to orient ourselves better, I'll turn on this mosaic blur node that allows us to limit the number of hues to our liking. I'll make the scope bigger and adjust the amount of colors to our liking. You can see the dots in the scope and the spikes in the hue versus luma curve move around. Then I start this odd dance, adjusting the hue, then adjusting the saturation, and then the luminance, as all these affect the color in rather unpredictable ways. And after some work, these seven hues match each other rather perfectly. Then I'll offset the mosaic a bit and start the dance again, for the in-between hues, as you can see, are quite different from the ones that we just matched. And then I do the same thing again, one more time. And again. Then I'll make sure that the transition between hues are smooth. Then we transition to the first specialty diagram that I built just for DaVinci Resolve. These three diagrams are very special. As you can see in the 3D vectorscope, these map a special cross-section of the color space. The teal and orange map skin tones and teal colors. The next one maps green and magenta colors. And the last one is just the skin tones. The reason why these are made into this organic shape is that these can be used with the color warper chroma luma tool, as this separates the two grids perfectly from each other at 50 degree angle, allowing us to work with the skin tones and the opposite teal and the perpendicular green and magenta colors individually. This allows us to really dial in the density of our colors. I'll adjust the mosaic node to show a limited amount of colors. I'll set our viewport black and white and start working with the luminance of the color squares. I'll pin the neutral colors, then I'll start matching the luminance of the different saturations to match the LUT. By moving the mask, I can see that they look the same in black and white. Then I'll turn the color back and then try my best to match the saturation of the squares as well. This starts to be very intuitive at this point. Then I'll switch to the green and magenta diagram and repeat the same process. Then I'll start working with the skin tones. And as we can see, there's a hue difference between our skin tones below and the LUT skin tones. I'll start matching them with the hue saturation warper and the hue curves. To fine-tune the skin tones, I'll switch to this alternative skin tone diagram. This is another skin tone diagram. This shows the most common light and dark skin tones as two gradients. In the 3D vectorscope, you can see these as these two blades floating at different exposures, representing the lighter and the darker human skin tones. I'm now fine-tuning the skin tones with different tools to get a closer match. Then after theoretically getting them to match to look good, I'll switch to check the skin tones on actual skin. I have an array of clips to fine-tune my power grade, and now I'm fine-tuning the skin to my liking. As I said in the beginning, I would like my skin to be less yellow, so this is where I'll fix that as well. Then I'm checking other colors as well. Then I'm bringing in even more clips just to try and find things I would like to improve, like this red sweater color and these yellow pants. And after a lot of tweaking, we are done. Here are some comparisons. This is the lookup table, and this is our recreation, our parametric power grade. This one looks very similar, but here I think our skin tones are better. There's more details in the sky, for example, as you can see, as these buildings appear out of nowhere and this lamppost just appears out of the fog. But sometimes the differences are bigger because perfect match is not possible with the native tools. But in general, I think our one looks better. So I hope you have now landed well back into our normal reality. And I have now compiled this film color emulation into a one handy power grade. This assumes you're using ACCCT as your working color. If you are, then you only need to drag and drop this on your signal path and it works. But if you're working in some other log color space, then you need to peek inside the group And inside this, there is this in node. And change the input to be the color space your camera shoots in. For example, SLOG3 and SCAMO3 Cine. Then in the out node, you will choose the out color space you would like to go out to. If you want to go back to SLOG3 and SCAMO3 Cine, you choose it here. Then outside of the group, you can edit the overall strength of the key in the key tab, or you can dive all in and change the individual elements here. For example, the tone curve by turning it off or lowering its strength in the key tab. As everything is parametric, you can edit this as you wish. And here's the link where you can download this power grade. From the same link, you can learn how to emulate other aspects of film, not only the color. Go there and check out my workshop as well, where I teach you a professional and very simple workflow on how to emulate film. And subscribe to the channel and see you in the next video. Oh, it's lunchtime.